Hey, welcome to OffPlanet TV. I'm Randy Moggins. With me is Emily Moyer, my brilliant co-host and producer.
And also pain in the ass.
What you're getting now is going to be kind of like what we do when we're not on air, because we're just going to collide with the reality stream around us. Since it's colliding with us anyway, especially me, I'm like a vortex right now. But I guess just to kind of, we're going to just move some ideas around, some concepts, some thoughts, because this is what we do all the time. We basically just bounce off of each other. And what comes out of that stew sometimes boils over into the air. How you doing?
I'm doing great, you know, so yeah, happy to be here. And we're going to just kind of let you guys hear one of our usual kind of private conversations or whatever today. Hopefully that will be interesting and entertaining for you. If not, that's okay too.
Yeah, think of it as Halloween without the masks.
There you go. We don't need masks. It's very scary.
No, we don't need masks because with this, everybody else is wearing them. Our job is to take the damn things off of people.
Yeah, I don't know. Halloween has never been, I've never been that into it, and I don't really like masks. And like, yeah, I don't know. Like, I guess the only thing I ever liked about it was the candy, because I wasn't allowed to eat candy when I was little, so that was the only chance I got to eat candy. But yeah, I'm just not that into it. I don't know. I guess I, even before I understood about the darker forces associated with it, I kind of felt that. And yeah, I'm just not into it. The girl at my work wants to take her kid trick-or-treating at night, so I'm like, I'll work for you. That's perfect. That way I don't have to deal with trick-or-treaters.
Well, the origins of it, we know all that about Samhain and, you know, all of the spirits that fly. But I think, too, with Halloween, it's become a commercial holiday on scale with Christmas. It's actually now. This is just like pre-Christmas.
Yeah.
Which you know, because of the work that you do in marketing.
Yeah.
Which my wife does also, especially in the real retail sector, how this all is just kind of the grease that gets the juices flowing for the holiday season, which is Christmas.
Absolutely. I was at PetSmart the other day buying some litter for my cat. And at PetSmart, the pet shop, it looked like Toys R Us. There's so many costumes for the goddamn dogs and cats and all that kind of shit. And everybody's there buying. I mean, it felt like I was at Toys R Us when I was like 6 years old before Halloween.
Yeah.
And no, absolutely. I mean, it's like weird. Like in some of the stores, I work mostly in a restaurant, but I do some part-time work, doing some merchandising and stuff like that. And it's weird because we have all this Halloween stuff, but they're already starting to play Christmas music. So we have the Halloween shit and the Christmas music. Yeah.
So somewhere out there, the Christians and the Satanists need to get together and figure this out, because they're going one with that. They're just like, they like park the trucks beside each other in the parking lots and unload the goodies. It's all commercialism. It's all Babylon. It's all designed to install, you know.
At this point, I think the Christians and the Satanists might be in the same truck. I don't even
know. They are. It is. It's true. Yeah. You know.
I'm not seeing much difference these days.
Well, the odd thing is that a long time ago it got infiltrated. I mean, you just look at the Vatican and you look at what's going on in Christianity. I mean, if Christianity is the religion of peace, which is what Islam was supposed to be,
right?
It's kind of lost on me about the whole Crusades thing.
Yeah.
And how many people died in order for that religion to exist.
Yeah.
So, you know, now we're busting on Islam and say, which, you know, let's face it, this is all set up. It's always been about the mask in front of the face.
Yeah.
And the Wizard of Oz and don't look at that man behind the curtain.
Yeah, and it's the same man behind all the curtains and behind all the masks and whatever. Yeah, it's like the Scooby-Doo. At the end of the episode, they would always pull the mask off and it was the same person. Yeah. That's where we are.
So, yeah, I don't know a lot about Scooby-Doo, but he was kind of creepy too. It seems to come up time and again about these cartoons and the Smurfs. Yeah. Like, how creepy are the Smurfs?
Well, they lived in mushrooms, which I kind of am partial to. But there is weird stuff in those cartoons. I mean, there was a lot of predictive programming there, a lot of mind control. I still catch myself singing the Smurf song. You know what I mean? So I'll be at work and I'll be like, la, 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 la. I'm like, uh-oh. I'm like, at this point, I just wonder, is that like some sort of like demon trying to access me or what the hell is going on? You know?
It is.
So, yeah.
I mean, I grew up in the era of the Mickey Mouse Club, you know, when, which was the premier gateway for MK Ultra to start doing their child acquisition. I mean, once they figured out that not only could they get into our living rooms and get into our children's heads, then they figured out new ways to get the children themselves so that they could get completely into their heads.
So, yeah, absolutely. You know, I'll share a story that I haven't shared on the air. So I wasn't in the Mickey Mouse Club, but, you know, I was a gymnast and I had some Hollywood stuff. And we used to go, some girls from my gym and some other local gyms, we used to go and be on a little like Nickelodeon thing called Mousercise. Oh, hold on, my phone's ringing. We used to go be on something called Mousercise. And I remember the woman's name who was like the teacher. It was like aerobics for little kids. And the woman's name was Kellen. She was the teacher. But yeah, so, I mean, think about that. We're talking about all these different like variants and offshoots of programs. So there you have my gymnastics being combined with the Mickey Mouse Club kind of thing. You know what I mean? And it was weird. It was weird. I mean, like, I think when I was little, I thought it was cool because we didn't know any better, but it is kind of weird, man. Mousercise, well, really?
I remember that too. I remember the Mousercise thing, yeah. I mean, you know, somewhere back in the distant memory. But we've talked about this, you know, I didn't grow up in LA. I didn't grow up really near New York City, but I wound up on local kids' TV shows when I was a kid, which is kind of weird, you know, some show about birthday parties. And then there was Romper Room, which they did.
I used to love Romper Room when I was little.
Yeah. You know, I gotta say, you know, I look back at the pictures. I can be objective now.
Yeah.
I was pretty cute.
Yeah. So,
and I was smiley and photogenic, and I get all that. But the whole idea of pushing little kids in front of cameras.
Yeah.
And then understanding that there's this whole marketing that goes on in the background.
Totally.
You know?
There's so much. So, yeah, absolutely. There was so much weird stuff like that that I did. So I also did, I did for a couple of years straight what was called the Nissan exhibition. And it was when, so all the car companies, they would have the car show, like the auto show down at the convention center here. And most of the car, like most of the like different kinds of cars would have like, you know, Playboy kinds of people at their cars. But for some reason, Nissan was, I think that it was in 1984. So I think they were the sponsor for the Olympics. So they decided they wanted to have gymnasts. So we would come and we would do these 15-minute exhibitions, and we would do it like 4 or 5, 6 times throughout the day. You know what I mean? And then go home and come back and do it again the next day. So there's that. So already at that age, you know, tying that kind of performance and the gymnastics to advertising and marketing. You know, and then also I would go on like morning shows like Good Day LA and the Today Show and do tricks. They would just have us on to do tricks. And I liked doing tricks. And so, you know, I didn't understand what I was doing. I thought it was cool. I'm on TV. I'm doing tricks. But that, like, there's something weird about that. They don't do that with people anymore. Now they have dogs on those shows to do tricks. So I guess dogs have supplanted people as interesting to watch doing tricks. You know?
People were about to be supplanted by CGI.
I think some people have already been supplanted by CGI.
They have.
Yeah. And so that kind of takes us to what we were just talking about for a second.
I just read somewhere that within the next decade, it's believed that CGI is going to take over completely and that most films will be filmed without live actors because it's just become too inconvenient.
You have to feed
people. Yeah. You have to insure them. Right. They have this habit of drug overdosing and dying mysteriously because their contracts are suddenly up.
Yeah.
CGI is so much easier. But, you know, it does beg the question, will we be so obsolete at that point that the intelligence agencies won't even want to recruit us anymore? And I'm kind of going, that sounds like a win.
CGI, holographic CGI, MKUltra and shit like that.
You just bypass little man completely. You just run the program now. You don't need the people anymore.
You know, I think there's been lots of things coming up in conversations this week that go to that. I agree with that. I mean, obviously they started doing that stuff with the holograms and like Tupac Shakur at Coachella and then that thing with Michael Jackson that time. And yeah, like it's, I mean, it, like it's, in that, you know, that was a couple years ago. At that stage, you could still sort of tell that it wasn't the real person there, but from far away, it looked pretty impressive, you know? But just like with cell phones and computing power, every day that stuff gets better and better and cleaner and cleaner. And I'm not certain that we aren't having that amongst us now. Like, I think, it is possible sometimes, like when you're in a large masses of people, that they're experimenting with having things walk through crowds that aren't actually there. I actually feel like that's occurred sometimes. Well, I think I've had something at parties that where it looks like something is there and it's actually, really not, but something like that. But I've also had a thing where I think that there's some like experimenting with using things being cloaked, because there's been times where I felt like I was like bumping into somebody and like having to like squeeze between people, but there was nobody there. I don't know if anyone's ever, so I'm sure lots of people who watch the show listen to Higher Side Chats. Several months back, he had on somebody who was written a book called Project Camellio. And in the course of that interview, it was talked about, basically a kind of cloaking technology where there would be like a person in this guy's apartment, but he wouldn't be able to see him except for like, if you look at himself in the mirror, he might be able to see the person behind himself. So you couldn't see him when you're looking at him, but maybe the technology wasn't working exactly properly. So you could see it, you could see it in the mirror, or sometimes you just you catch little pixelated bits of it, but for all intents and purposes, somebody was there, but you couldn't see them. So I think that, I think they're playing with that kind of stuff. I think it exists, obviously, in Hollywood and whatever, but I think we're probably already intermingling with it. We just aren't necessarily super aware of it, and then I also think, and Randy and I were just a few minutes before we came on, we were talking about, Julian Assange, and so we were talking, Randy said that he wasn't sure he was even alive, and my thing, I don't know if any of you guys ever follow this guy, Montagraph, on YouTube. He does some good stuff sometimes, and he's been saying for a long time now, he was the first person that I, for over a month, maybe longer than that, that he doesn't think, it's probably been 2 months or three, he feels that Julian Assange is either dead or in custody, and that like all the things that have been coming out on WikiLeaks, like Twitters and things like that, and certain announcements they've made, it's compromised. I mean, not that they weren't always compromised on a different level than that, but that at this point, we're not even dealing with Julian Assange. And then Randy said, well, have we ever been? Like, I'm not convinced that, he's like, what about all the CGI kind of stuff? And I guess I hadn't really considered CGI with Julian Assange, but I had considered the CGI thing with Edward Snowden.
Edward Snowden, yeah.
Partly, he always looked weird to me. Like, he always was like, pale in a way that was different than someone who was just pale. He was almost translucent. He is almost translucent. And there's some weird things about Adam Curry pointed out at one point that like he has a piece of his glasses that is broken. And like 2 years out, that piece of his glasses is still broken. Like, wouldn't they have like gotten him some new glasses by now? I heard, again, referring back to another episode of Higher Side Chats, Greg has some great shows, so I do check those out very frequently. He had someone on, I can't remember his name right now, who is like really like one of these guys who thinks that lots and lots and lots of things are fake, right? I think we all have a range of how much stuff we think is fake and how much we think is real, and this guy's pretty far on the thinking most things is fake. But he brought up the thing that he's felt like Edward Snowden is a CGI, that he doesn't really exist. And some of the proof he had, and I actually looked at some of his videos, was you could sort of see like something through him. Like there was something moving in the background and you could see it through him. And some of that stuff came up with some of the things with the Hillary post-fall 9/11, where that kind of stuff. So whether that means there is or isn't an Edward Snowden, I don't know. A lot of people have talked about maybe all of these debates have been some sort of CGI or green screen kind of thing. There's all sorts, we are living in this age, so I think probably what we're witnessing is a little of everything going on. I don't think it's all one thing or the other, but it's really hard to know what is to fucking know these days. Like, this is crazy.
Well, I think there's a mix of technology going on, and especially with the Hillary Clinton thing. I don't think, given what we've uncovered in terms of at least 3 to 4 drop-ins of Hillary Clinton, something's walking around out there as Hillary Clinton right now that's not Hillary Clinton, and we don't know which one it is and when they're dropping them in, or if or when there is an actual Hillary Clinton engaged in all of this.
Yeah.
But this kind of goes down that whole road with the Paul McCartney thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got to remember something. I grew up when the tail end of the 60s, the beginning of the 70s. And I remember the persistent rumors about the Paul McCartney thing. Now, you got to remember, there was no internet then, but there was a social network, sort of.
Yeah.
That came out of fanzines,
yeah,
underground newspapers, and the networks that grew up around universities.
Yeah.
So, you know, in that time, there was still ways to communicate in an underground modality.
Absolutely, yeah.
And so you go and you look at this, and I got to tell you, the more I looked at the Paul McCartney death thing, the more convinced I was. But over the years, you know, I was a kid. You grow up, you get over it. The Beatles were pretty much over by the time I was in my prime. I mean, it was Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath.
Yeah.
We were going into the era of progressive rock with things like Genesis. And don't forget, we weren't that far away from disco, which was coming in, and ultimately punk rock.
And punk rock and the new wave and all that. Yeah.
You know, a lot of things very rapid, but you got used to the concept that whoever that was in the Beatles, that now was Paul McCartney. And even I did. You allowed yourself to be shamed into thinking that you're completely delusional, which is the story of my life anyway. So why would that fucking bother me now?
Right.
But I'll show you something. And I'll tell you why this is important, because we're talking about Hillary Clinton, Edward Snowden, all of these public people that seem real to us. But what if all of this is gigantic intelligence agency cutout operations designed to control us emotionally and keep us engaged? Now,
what if it's a movie that's just not on the screen? That's more like an
what's a Truman
show? Like street theater, like theater, like, you know, when you're like on the street, like it's interacting with you and you don't even know that I always love that line that Marilyn Manson said, we're all stars now in the dope show. This is the fucking dope show.
This is it. So the McCartney thing's important. Why? Well, go back and look at pictures of Paul McCartney between 1965 and 1966. And the word is that McCartney died in a car crash on September 11th, 1966. And those clues are on the cover of Sgt. Pepper's, and most people who were working on this thought he died on November 9th. Because of the way the British do their dates, instead of month first, it's day first. So it's 11-9 rather than 9-11. Yeah. But in the book, the Billy Shears book.
Tell everybody for a second what you're talking about, just in case they haven't seen Sage of Quay's show on that.
Let me get the book.
Yeah. Randy's talking about, so there's a new book that came out. Not new, maybe it came out a few years ago. That is.
I told you this was going to be a loose show. You get it all. You get the squeaky doors, me running about madly in the Batcave.
What?
The whole deal. My headphones coming in backwards, which means I can't.
So while you were gone, I was just starting to explain to them what you're talking about. That I was explaining that there's a,
This is the book that's
taken. Tell them what it is.
Yeah, this is called The Memoirs of Billy Shears. This is actually selections from the larger work called The Memoirs of Billy Shears. This is called Billy's Back. This is an excerpt of the, I don't have the big book yet. I haven't gotten it. The big book, which is called The Memoirs of Billy Shears, is a 666-page book that breaks down exactly how Paul McCartney died in 1966. And how he was replaced by a man named William Shepherd, a.k.a. Billy Shears, because the Shepherd Shears.
Yeah.
And how he went through surgeries and facial alterations, how he had to learn to play guitar and bass left-handed, the whole mystical aspect to this. This is what this book is. It's an occult book.
Yeah, how he had to let the spirit of Paul McCartney come into his body, all that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, it even talks about a seance that the Beatles had in 1967 in December, how on October 31st, 1966, you know, a month and change after McCartney was killed, he was able to begin channeling Paul McCartney when he attempted to play bass left-handed. Now, William Shepherd's a right-handed guitar player. He's actually an accomplished musician. His challenge, with all the facial work that was being done, with all the things that had to be done to make him look like James Paul McCartney, he had to figure out how he was going to play bass left-handed. Now, I got to tell you something. I played guitar since I was about 16. And I've sat down and I don't have it here right now, but I did have a left-handed guitar here for a while because my son left it here. He's left-handed. That's a challenge because everything you do on a guitar neck is now inverted.
Yeah.
So what this book tells you is that this was basically a cutout operation. It probably goes deeper than the book itself. I read this book. I went through anger over it. I felt pissed off by the fact that somebody could even write this book in the first place, much less the prospect that Paul McCartney could write this book, or the man we call Paul McCartney. So the book is written as a work of fiction with plausible deniability for legal reasons, because quite frankly, if this book is true, the amount of fraud that has gone into the Beatles since 1966 is on the scale of something, we're talking billions of dollars.
Not only that, but then it calls into question everything that's come after that, which we already know there's a lot of weird stuff with in music of the 60s and 70s. You know, I'm suspect of it all. So are we looking at like, at least as far as like the mainstream popular music goes, a complete, not only like, have we been being fed bullshit in terms of quality of the music a lot of time, but is the whole thing just absolute bullshit, like even beyond the level that we already know it is?
This way, what if this was a trial run to see, because we know the Beatles were fronted by MI5, EMI Records, which ran the Beatles, which ran Abbey Road, which ran George Martin and Brian Epstein and all the people behind the Beatles. That was pretty much a cutout operation with military technology.
Yeah.
George Martin had deep ties back to British Secret Service. And it looks to me like the whole thing was, well, it says here in the book, in this book again, that it was being run by the Tavistock Institute.
Yeah.
Which we already kind of knew. That goes into the Committee of 300 and even the concept that, you know, Theodore Adorno possibly was the author or at least the inspiration for a lot of the Beatles music.
Visigoth, however you say it, didn't he do some really good shows on Theodore Adorno?
Well, John Coleman, who wrote the Committee of 300, was a guest on there a number of times.
Yeah.
And Coleman kind of spun off this whole thing about the Committee of 300.
Yeah.
Which, you know, is the super, like, I guess the guiding committee behind what you would call the Illuminati and all the various factions that it orchestrates.
So is this interchangeable with like the Club of Rome and things like that, right?
Well, it probably encompasses all of that.
Yeah.
You know, the P2 Lodge, the Illuminati, the Freemasonry Lodges.
Jason Society, all that kind of stuff.
So. All of that. I mean, it's all part and parcel. There's compartmentalization, obviously. So like the Beatles were Masonic, that's very clear.
Yeah.
And again, the memoirs of Billy Shears goes into the Masonic aspects of this, which I've known for a long time. It goes into Satanism, how the Beatles and the Rolling Stones were basically very deeply into Satanism.
Yeah.
How?
Oh, you mean they're a Christian? No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding.
That was a whole John Lennon more popular.
And also, I know we have some listeners that are Christians. I'm not making fun of you.
Well,
I'm making fun of organized religion. Yeah.
And anybody that knows my background knows that. I mean, I still dance on that because that's my roots and because I'm not going to disclaim what I actually believe.
I just hate
the religious thing.
Yeah, and that's the same way I feel. People who are, you know, spiritually, you know, there's some good points to Christianity. Most of the religious Christians don't follow that. The spiritual Christians, I don't have a problem with that. So, yeah, I just wanted to make that clear. I know.
Yeah, so, you know, anyway, I'll show you what I found. So anybody that remembers Paul McCartney from 1966 and even through the Beatles era 1967 when they released Sgt. Pepper's up through 1970. You know, Paul McCartney's hair was what color? If you don't know the answer, you're forgiven because you didn't grow up in that.
I always thought it was like brown, dark brown or black.
It's black.
Yeah.
Paul McCartney's hair was black.
Yeah.
Paul McCartney's hair on Sgt. Pepper's, if you look at it, was black. The book, The Memoirs of Billy Shears, tells you that Bill Shepard, among all the other things he had to do, was he had to dye his hair black. But they've gotten so brazen.
Yeah.
I want to show you this. I don't know how well this detail will show up. This.
Oh, yeah. It's like light brown.
See it?
Yep.
His hair is the color of the mahogany bouts.
Yeah.
On this Epiphone guitar. That's the Paul McCartney.
When is that picture supposedly from?
This picture is from 2009. This is Guitar Player magazine.
Okay,
I was just going through old magazines and I went, what?
Yeah.
I looked at it. This is McCartney in 2009. This is the Epiphone guitar. That's the replica of the guitar that was used.
That's Bill Shepard. That's William Shepard.
That's William Shepard.
Okay.
The guitar he's holding there is a replica of the Epiphone guitar that was used by the original McCartney to write Yesterday.
Okay.
Look at his hair. It's
it's like reddish brown.
It's like reddish brown. Now, in 2009, McCartney at this point is...
That's about the time the stuff was going on with Heather Mills and all that kind of stuff, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
He was easily in his mid-60s at this point. Who in their mid-60s has their black hair suddenly go to auburn?
Right.
Really? I mean, now he's gray. His face is starting to collapse. The guy that plays McCartney now is probably close to 80 because Bill Shepard was older than James Paul McCartney.
Yeah.
So all of this to say this, the elaborate illusion is what's real and what's not real, who gets dropped in. What a joke on the American people if they vote for Hillary Clinton, if she's elected and she's dead, and we elect what? A closet full of clones, a bunch of walk-ins. The first CGI president.
Yeah. No, I mean,
this is beautiful.
Or even what if by some way Trump wins or they let Trump win or whatever, and they don't like that. So then they kill him. And then there's like a Trump clone or a Trump CGI that's suddenly doing the things that they wanted to do, which might just be Trump himself, because I'm not sure he's being honest with people anyway. But at this point, we are not in Kansas anymore, kids, you know, it's one of these, I don't know, I was thinking about this today, like, we really have to be very responsible about dealing with everything we take in, just like we have to pay attention to what we're eating because the food is poison now. You know, it shouldn't be like that in an ideal world. You know, all food should be organic and good for you. It should be a rare thing that something bad happens with food, but that's not the world we live in.
Yeah, organics is what, or they're marketing it as organics. This is what we used to call food.
Oh, yeah. And so
in between, they went from food to crap that they sold us, and we went, well, this doesn't taste very good, and I'm getting sick from it.
Yeah.
They went, oh, here, have this. It's organic.
And you're going,
okay.
Yeah.
So we'll just slap a label on that.
Yeah. And so the same thing goes for information, especially because people like us who are trying to figure shit out and get past this paradigm, for us, information is like food. And all the information we take in, we have to really look at it and make sure, just like we're not getting slipped GMOs and fluoride water and stuff like that. We have to understand the information we're taking in. And I'm not saying that it's possible for any of us to do that 100% or perfectly, but we are at that point where we have to consider all options. And so we can't accept, it's unfortunate that we can't accept information that comes from other human beings on face value, but we can't. And sometimes it's not even their fault. Like everybody is so, you know, like we like, I'm sure we like to consider ourselves more informed than the rest of the people that we consider asleep, but we could be just informed about different misinformation or a different, you know, like we could be being fooled in a different way, but we have to be really careful about what we take to heart and how we make our decisions and, you know, and not let ourselves get caught up in this nonsense, because all these people are fighting about Hillary and Donald and all that. And like, it's not, none of this is real. You know what I mean? So I think the only, we have to keep certain people and certain concepts and certain things close to us and make our decisions based on that and not get so caught up in these things that we can't even know what they are at this point.
And that brings us into this whole Facebook thing and the alternative media that's been roiling all summer long. I mean, we began this summer. We've gone through, summer's over now, but
not here.
The summer, you're in, of course, LA. Land of eternal summer. That never rains in California, right?
Right.
But we went through the summer with just a whole series of people being outed, people being kicked to the curb. You know, it's really been turbulent. To even begin to name all of them, obviously, is very difficult. The two trigger events, obviously, the exposure of Zen Gardner and then the
death of Max Spears.
Right. And the death of Max Spears has become almost as creepy and nearly as legend building in its own way and on its own scale as the McCartney thing.
Yeah.
Because quite frankly, what has boiled out over all of this is that nobody knows shit about it and everybody's been talking about it.
Yeah, I've stayed out of that for the most part. I didn't know Max Spears. He seemed like a nice person. His story never resonated with me in the same way that someone like Duncan or Elisa's stories did. But he seemed like a nice person who's obviously been traumatized. But there is something weird about the way people are acting about this and how it happened and then it disappeared and now it's back and it's being talked about in the regular conspiracy circles, not just in our fringe MK mind control kind of circles. And he's being called a conspiracy theorist and a UFO researcher and an alien insider and all these things. And maybe even an alien inside, I don't know. He seemed like he was a lovely person. Sorry for his family and for him and whatever. But there is also this like weird, like you kind of mentioned, weird cult of women around him.
No, it's kind of, it's a weird death cult.
The other thing that I noticed that I just wanted to say, I think I don't ever watch Miles Johnston's videos. He never resonated with me at all, but they do come up in my feed sometimes. And just, I think 2 days ago, there's a new interview with a new person and he looks almost, he had sunglasses on so you can't see his eyes, but his haircut and his face and his shape and everything, he looks just like a Max Spears cutout. It's like, there's something weird. And it wouldn't surprise me if he becomes really popular with all the girls who are MK groupies and shit too. Like there's something weird going on there. They're like, you know, like this is not like a, this is gross.
Well, what's happened is that the mainstream media has noticed that there's significant motion in this area. I mean, you've got to remember that when Duncan came out, when he did, which was two-pointed thing, Jesse Ventura and then the Project Camelot interviews, that he was really, I won't say he was the first because I don't know that, he was the first who pushed the profile out and gave it a face.
At least of the quote unquote, term, super soldier genre. Like we've obviously heard of people like Bryce Taylor and Kathy O'Brien and things like that, the kind of sex slave.
The sex slave, the sex monarch model.
Right, but for the kind of thing that Duncan was talking about, he was really the first one to come out in a big way. And then, you know, he's the one, in my opinion, who all of these, for lack of a better term, cutouts have been modeled after. Yeah.
And that's not to say, because you and I both know,
there are
legitimate people that are coming forward.
And even some of these people may be legitimate, but they're being manipulated into exaggerating.
That's the worst part of it.
They're being manipulated into fulfilling an agenda that is creating like this cult of celebrity mind control soldiers that, it's very weird. I don't understand. It's they're being, so even if their stories might even be very true, but then they're being manipulated to portray them in this way, to do these speaking tours. It's very weird. Like, it doesn't, it's not normal. And what's normal, but you know, there's something they're being, I'm sure, in order to be subject to be manipulated that way, you have to have been traumatized in some way anyway. So I'm not trying to say that nothing is going on with these people or that they're not in some ways who they say they are, but there's an operation being done on them that they're still part of, whether they recognize it or not. So it's like if they've really broken free from one programming, they've just gone into another. And, you know,
well, you and I both know, and this kind of gets down to the real, it's very hard to talk about these kind of things.
Yeah.
I mean, your personal experiences with them. I was outed, you know, probably 2 years out when I started doing this show because of my UFO experiences.
Yeah.
It took a while for me to just go, okay, because I really did this show as a kind of vicarious way of talking about it without actually talking about it.
Yeah.
I've realized that there's a lot of people that talk to both of us. And I mean, I've talked to a lot of people over the years. I've had conversations, phone calls, tons of information dumped that I can't use because, quite frankly, there's people they want to talk, but they're not ready to be public and they don't know how to do that.
Yeah.
And even when they are public, they're not comfortable like Eliza. You know, it's comfortable to a degree, but it's not comfortable. You know, I think about Chris Neal, who's come up again. I think I've sort of, you know, brought Chris Neal's blog forward again because I think that needs to be remembered in terms of what somebody who's disclosing can look like, because he's a real face, a real person. And what he did was, he said, I'm going to write this blog.
Yeah.
And when he began to call out the frauds, such as Michael Hemmingson, former White Hat, this whole game got real dangerous.
Yeah.
And what has happened is there's a harvesting operation. We talked about this when we had Elise on our show.
Yeah.
About conferences and things like that.
Yeah.
Project Camelot and Bases both run conferences. That's really their big deal. I mean, nominally, they are what you would call internet shows. I mean, they both put stuff out, but I don't think they do. The way we do things is unique to us, and that's as it should be. There's not a comparison.
Yeah.
Somebody accused me a long time ago of being in competition with Project Camelot, and I went, I have no interest in that.
It's a completely different thing. Like, I see Camelot as being like Walmart, and we're some weird shop down on Melrose that is,
you know, we're the head shop behind, like,
crawl through a hole in the ceiling to get
in West Hollywood. So I mean, it's not, in all of this you have to judge what's real and who's real and who's being used. I looked at the video of Max from Poland on Sunday because I spent most of Sunday dealing with the fallout from the show that I did with Duncan. And oddly enough, the fallout came in interesting ways from where I didn't expect it.
Yeah.
And in ways I didn't expect it, from people who just frankly lost it. I spent 15 minutes on the phone with one female radio talk show host who just screamed at me. And I had stalking connections on Facebook again, which goes back to why I dropped off Facebook. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, finish what you're saying and then let's get to the issue of Facebook, because I know you wanted to talk about that.
Well, it's all connected. Specifically Facebook, because of the way it functions, there is a way there that they're aggregating people that creates a neural network.
Well, I've noticed this thing, and I've been having to remove myself from this. People can add you to groups without you saying you want to be in the group. And so some of them, when I notice it, I just pull myself out right away. Other times, there's some people in there that I like or that looks like it might be interesting. I'll watch it for a while. But I'm just going to say, I don't like that. I don't want to be added to things without asking if I want to be added. I'm talking to Facebook, and I'm talking, but we're also, there's people who are in these circles, who are other radio show hosts, who are listeners, who are doing that. And I think we need to become very respectful of each other's space. And we now have an extension of ourselves online, and don't add people to groups without asking them. Just don't do it. If your group is interesting, send them an invitation, and they want, and if they want to join, they will join. Don't put some, don't, you know, then I think some people just friend you only so they can add you to their group, so their group looks bigger, so it has higher rankings or whatever. Don't do that. Be nice. It's like walking into somebody's house without asking if you can come over. You know what I mean? Don't do it. It's not nice.
Well, the other side of this is a lot of intercourse, and I'm using that term deliberately here, on Facebook is very much like casual sex was in the late 70s and early 80s. There's a lot of cocaine, wild parties, and a lot of VD going around as a result of it. We're intercoursing with people in a way that is affecting us on a neurological level and on a psychic level. And when I dropped off Facebook, you know this, I did it because I was out of control. And I had to take responsibility for that. There was a lot of rage that was going around at that point. There was a lot of stalking. I was watching people turn on me for seemingly no reason. And I was watching myself also become very aggressive in ways that when I stepped back from it, I went, that's just wrong. That's not really who I am. Most people who have known me for any period of time know that's not really, I can be aggressive, but I'm not this ravening wolf. So it came down to the point where I needed to detox. I needed to get off Facebook. And quite frankly, I needed to get away from electronic media as much as I possibly could.
Yeah.
I lost 3 routers in my house over this period of time. My internet, I could not hold an internet connection here. It was so bad that the Comcast people came in, tore out every last square foot of wiring right out to the pole.
I wonder what they put in there instead, Randy. I'm still worried about that.
My phone was bricked. My mobile phone was bricked. I had to replace that. There was a lot going on, and there's still a lot going on, and I've just come to accept it. I noticed that my new phone seems to reboot itself at particularly sensitive moments in conversations that actually happened between Robert Phoenix and I when we were talking about Hillary Clinton being a clone or possibly even a human-alien hybrid.
You know what's weird? Like, Elisa and I, for a period of time, whenever like discussion of entities would come up in our phone conversations, we would lose signal. It is weird. You know what I mean? Like, it is bizarre. I do want to say, so when all that stuff went down, when you went off Facebook, I was really, so in like the day before that, like I had noticed some of the bantering back and forth you were doing. And I was like, I just remember thinking to myself, God, like he has a point, but I don't, you know, it's like, that's not really who he is. I don't really like that he does that. And then the very next day you said, I don't know what I'm doing. I need to get off that. It's not how I am. And so I really appreciated that you were taking an inventory of yourself and being responsible for your behavior and taking care of yourself. And I think that, and this is not a criticism of people, but I think we all need to do that from time to time. And so even some of these people who you've had these really difficult back and forth with, you know, if you're listening, you guys, like, just check yourself. We all need to do it sometimes. And stop, you know, if you're acting in a way that isn't innate to who you are and to how you want to portray yourself to people and how you want people to feel you, then stop it. Turn the shit off for a little while. Shut your page down for a couple days and think about it. And, you know, one of the things that I do, like, you know, I'm not super active on Facebook. I respond to messages and I occasionally comment or like or things like that. But, you know, I think about, is this like, I don't like it when something tries to get me to act in a way that wouldn't be how I act naturally. And so I don't do that. Even if something pisses me off, even if I have to bite my tongue, if it doesn't feel good to who I am, I don't say it. You know, I don't say it and I don't do it. And I just think that, you know, I'm not saying the way I do things is right, but just, I don't get into some of the stuff on Facebook that everybody else does. And it's not that I couldn't, but I'm very careful with that to just make sure that I'm not being, you know, kind of pushed into a corner where I say something that isn't, you know, true to who I am just because, you know, somebody is, you know, being aggressive with me or something like that. Unfortunately, I don't have too many of those interactions. Sometimes I get criticism from people. That's okay. But there's also, you know, and I do want to say, we're not trying to say we don't want to have interaction with people. I had the great fortune yesterday of meeting one of our listeners in person. And we had a wonderful, amazing conversation. And I'm so glad I did that. So I'm definitely open to interacting with people. And I know Randy is too. We just, you know, it can, and we're even okay with criticism as long as it's respectful, intellectual, and constructive. You know what I mean?
No, I'm not good with criticism at all. I'm a loyal asshole about that. So anyway, there you go, kids. Safe tips for social intercoursing on Facebook and social media.
Take a little break, and when we come back, we're going to have a friend pop in for a little discussion. All right, guys, we'll be back in just a minute.
Your off-planet radio listening experience will return shortly.
This is Off Planet.
Welcome
Radio.
Back to Off Planet TV, and a friend is going to pop in and join us for the second hour. Robert Phoenix, welcome back to Off Planet TV.
Hey, it's my pleasure to be here with you guys.
Hey, Robert.
All right, we're going to cover the gamut with Robert. So let's get right into it. And as promised, he's back to give us his final thoughts on this election. Let us have it.
Well, before we jump into the election, I've been spending some time looking at the planets in James O'Keefe's chart. And they're absolutely fascinating. I started to work on a piece today and try to break down in detail what's going on with him. And for those people who are not familiar with James O'Keefe, he is the sort of the nominal head of Project Veritas. He was born in June 28th.
Day before me.
1984 in New Jersey. So he's pretty young guy. He's a millennial. We know he's right at the kind of the beginnings of the kind of the millennial wave. So he's an older millennial. And he's born in 1984, which is George Orwell's year, which I thought was kind of interesting.
Yeah.
He's a rat, born in the year of the rats. And rats, by their nature, tend to be quite clever people.
Yeah.
And clearly this is one clever dude. And it's fascinating to see his impact on the election and this awakening process. I think the work that he's done, and he's taking a lot of heat from people that are on the left and the progressive side, and to some extent even the mainstream media, who don't want to really give him much attention because it makes them look like utter fools.
Well, they just say he's discredited, but they don't prove it or say how he's discredited.
No, exactly. Yeah. So one of the latest pieces is that he's hired a guy to be a part of the organization, part of Project Veritas, who apparently blackmailed David Letterman at one point in time. So this is what they're hanging their hats on. And yeah, what's really fascinating is that we've gone into this kind of ad hominem attack culture, which is, let's not look at the message, destroy the messenger.
That's what I was saying to everybody. Like, that's what this whole WikiLeaks thing, like, and I was explaining this to my dad, and he actually didn't disagree with me, which is unusual. Like, people, no one is looking at the contents of the email. Hillary Clinton, Podesta, they're not saying that those aren't their emails. All they say when these things are brought up is it was the Russians. So people are not looking at the content. They're being distracted by it's the Russians. Well, even if it is the Russians, if the content of the emails are true, don't we still want to know that?
We are at the continental divide of consciousness right now.
Yeah.
And Randy and I actually were talking about this a couple of days ago when we were on the phone together.
Yeah.
And I, for a long time ago, I had this dream, and I really felt like that this dream was one of those, you know, lifetime keeper dreams. And I haven't really thought about it for a while, but in my dream, it was there was this amazing event that happened where all the animals turned sentient. We were having kind of this psychic relationship with the animal kingdom. It was really kind of a cool thing. And then I realized that in the dream that we were all kind of moving up this ladder of consciousness. And for whatever reason, Dick Cheney was in my dream, and I thought, oh my God, even Dick Cheney's along for the ride.
Yeah.
He's coming along, and I'm like, wow, this is really something. And in that moment when I woke up, it was like we all, you know, we all climb this ladder together. Nobody gets left behind.
Yeah.
And as years have gone by, it's not that I don't trust the validity of that dream, but I have seen that we've become split into this kind of bicameral consciousness. And I don't think everybody is going to get it. And I don't think everybody is going to move into this kind of new realm of awakening and truth and living from the heart and not giving our power away to these bullshit gatekeepers. Now, here's something really interesting. I don't know if you guys know about this, but Michael Moore has come out and said he's going to vote for Trump.
I saw that video yesterday. I was like, wow.
The setup.
Yeah.
Moore put out that movie last week, which he did on the fly, which theoretically was a hit piece on Trump. Now he's turned around and said he's going to vote for Trump. But it,
I mean, look, I'm going to believe that he has had a shift in his consciousness. I'm going to believe in that. That's going to be my takeaway.
Yeah.
On Michael Moore, and I'll just live with that. And he could be, you know, it could be another setup. It could be another trapdoor. It could be another cloak and dagger situation. But I'm going to invest in the energy that this guy has been able to move away from his party affiliation, or maybe what he's really done is he's really got back in touch with his roots.
Yeah.
And seeing the fact that
American Trump
is vehement about the TTIP,
yeah,
not sign that deal, Hillary will. And this would, if she did, this would go against everything that Michael Moore believes in.
Yeah.
So maybe this is really the tabula rasa that Michael Moore has clicked into and shifted his consciousness and his ideals. If that's the case, well, then good on him.
Yeah, well, his original work was all about, you know, factory workers and the American worker. And
that's
so,
right.
Absolutely, like, if he is really, truly a man who's going to vote his consciousness, then he absolutely cannot have the TPP or the TTIP. Or
well, and that was the core of the Democratic Party for generations. I mean, yeah. I come from a family that was steeped in the old Democratic Party. My grandfather was a railroad man who was actually a link between management and labor, who actually, there's a picture of him sitting at a breakfast table with Harry S. Truman at the latter part of the war, because the railroads were very much part of the strategy, also part of the Masonic circles. But it's, you know, when you really listen to Trump, what Trump did was he co-opted the Republican Party to basically bring in the old Democratic Party message. And Hillary is a neocon and has always been a neocon.
Yeah. Hey, Robert, go ahead.
Role reversals.
Yeah, Robert, I wanted to say something real quickly about your dream before we get too far away from it. So I just wanted to add this idea in that maybe your dream, this is something I've been thinking about lately, maybe your dream is that, yes, all of those of us who are actually human beings will rise together. And I think maybe some of what we're dealing with here is that some of these people around us are not organic human beings, or they're not the original kind of human beings. They're like a human being 2.0. And so their consciousness is either, you know, more immature, or they're just something different. And so those of us who, you know, me and Randy like to refer to when we talk about these things as like the original people or the first people or like organic human beings.
Bookmark this conversation, listeners, because we'll return to it with more detail soon.
Yeah. But and this isn't even a judgment, like, you know, about you know, others. But so I'd say if, you know, maybe if you look at it in that sense, then your dream is right on.
Yeah. Well, TBD, as they say. Look, I'm all for it. I'm tired of, you know, where the world has been and the division and the strife and the manipulation and all the things that have gone on to create a pretty crappy place to live for the most part in a hell of a world.
Is dinner ready?
Is dinner ready?
You said the ding.
No, that's my kid sending me. A kid got a minor concussion yesterday playing football, so that was him sending me his little concussion worksheet via text.
Oh, well, get well soon, Griffin.
Yeah, we saw that on Facebook. Yeah.
So I wanted to talk about James O'Keefe. And
yeah, let's get back there. Yeah.
Can we bring it back to that?
Yes, please.
I thought it was really interesting what's been going on and these videos, which are just, I love the fact that he blew these guys, Bob Cramer and Scott Fogel, out of the water with the Project Veritas. It's brilliant. Mm-hmm. Now, in true Democratic fashion, Bob Cramer says he's stepping away. Doesn't say he's stepping down, but he's stepping away. And Scott Fogel, you know, he'll surface somewhere else. They'll put him in some other capacity, some other organization. But what was really fascinating is watching Scott Fogel just gloat over the fact that he's the guy that runs Americans for Change. And I talked about this today. The hierarchy kind of goes like this. Super PAC and the banking families and all the people that want Hillary Clinton to do their bidding, they're on top of the pyramid. And then it's Hillary Clinton. And then it's the DNC. And then it's Democracy Partners.
Yeah.
And then it's Americans for Change.
Yeah.
Democracy United, Americans for Change. And that's how the hierarchy works. So it starts up here. And then again, if people don't quite understand this, the DNC is supposed to be a completely separate entity apart from these kind of subgroups who are operating as Hillary's kind of intelligence, feet on the streets, guerrilla tactics, guerrilla warfare, all that stuff. So they're not really supposed to be communicating. And what happens is that James O'Keefe and his crew completely blow that up, and they're communicating, they're conspiring. Mm-hmm. Doing all these things to create a chain of command, mm-hmm. and basically a what we call a paper trail, so it all winds up going back to Hillary Clinton, the DNC, and clearly in violation of laws that were put into place post-Watergate. Okay, so this is what happened. And Scott Fogel is gloating that he's the ultimate gorilla, you know, and he's being out-gorillaed by Project Veritas. I love it. It's great. It's absolutely, I mean, James O'Keefe should win an Oscar.
Yeah.
Best documentary.
A Pulitzer for journalism.
People should be throwing money at this guy.
Yeah.
For the work that he's done and being able to expose what everybody has been thinking about and trying to pin a tail on, you know, for the last three election cycles. And look, the Republicans are just as dirty, okay? Yep. But what sets Trump apart from the Republican Party is that Trump is an outsider, and they're playing by slightly different rules because he does not have the RNC backing him up. And Trump has his own money, and he has enough of a grassroots following so that he doesn't have to go out and trump up the results or trump up, you know, what's happening at his rallies. His people aren't going to Hillary's rallies. You know, there's no undercover kind of guerrilla theater, you know, a la Saul Alinsky happening at Hillary's rally, because nobody shows up at Hillary's rallies.
Well, also, because, you know, if there was, we'd be seeing that all over leftist media constantly, them showing
up. Absolutely. Yeah. They would spend the majority of their screen time.
Yeah.
So I want to get into James O'Keefe's chart. Like I said, he was born on the 28th of June, 1984 in New Jersey. Now, I don't have a birth time, but we could look at the solar chart. Number one, we see he's a Cancer. And what's really interesting about this is that Julian Assange is also a Cancer. And what's his name?
Edward Snowden.
Snowden, thank you. Snowden's not a Cancer. He's a Gemini, but he's right at the edge of Gemini. He's like, I think he's like 28 or 29 degrees Gemini. So you'll see that Gemini plays a role in James O'Keefe's chart. So he's 6 degrees Cancer. And what's interesting about him is that his sun is in conjunction. And for people that don't understand that word, it's when two bodies are, you know, closely together. There, in astrology, there's like rules for conjunctions about 10 degree separation. When you get in between 0 and 5, it's really, really close. So Donald Trump's Mercury is at 8 degrees Cancer. So his Mercury and James O'Keefe's sun are really close. So there, I would not be surprised if there is some deep collusion, deep pockets, deep money. Maybe Trump is actually funding Project Veritas. Would not be surprised around that, by the way. But so there's a real strong connection. Now his moon is in Gemini. Okay, so James O'Keefe's moon is in Gemini, and what is Donald Trump? He is a Gemini sun, and he has Uranus in Gemini, Trudeau in Gemini. Now I don't know the degree of his moon because I don't know the exact time he was born, but I guarantee you it's moon in Gemini and he is born under a balsamic moon. And the balsamic moon is the final phases of the moon before it goes into a new phase. So the new phase actually happens the day after he's born on the 29th with moon in Cancer. So he has this final degree of the moon in Gemini. Balsamic moon people, it's a moon of dispensation and dissolution. People that have balsamic moons tend to be very old souls because they have to continually give away whatever it is that comes into their life, whether it's a relationship, whether it's a goal. So if you look at James O'Keefe, you know, people have said, well, there's death threats on him, or he's a marked man, or, you know, my girlfriend said he has a death wish. In a lot of ways, this would be very congruent with somebody who has a balsamic moon.
Yeah.
And just being able to let it go, like, hey, I'm willing to let go of my life in order for this to come through. Now, remember, Gemini represents duplicity and duality. And there are two signs that are really connected to spycraft as far as, actually, I think there's three, but two that really stand out for me are Scorpio and Gemini. Gemini, you have, you know, duplicity, dual identities, you know, you have dual agencies.
Yeah.
Is perfect for that spycraft. He's got moon in Gemini. He also has Mercury in Gemini. And again, I don't know, you know, where his Mercury is in relationship to the moon, but I do know that it's a fairly early stage. It's at 12 degrees Gemini, puts it in the Libra decan. So he's using Mercury in Gemini to create this dual identity, which is, again, quite interesting. And today on my show, I was talking about Scorpio. Now, Scorpio is the sign of revelation. It is deep, deep revelation. It's like going, you know, inside something and mucking around and getting sort of the toxic contents of whatever it is and then pulling them up and out. And you'll see where this plays a role in James O'Keefe's chart. He has Venus. James O'Keefe has Venus in the sign of, again, Cancer. So we have a Sun-Venus conjunction. People that are Cancerian or have strong Cancerian aspects in their charts tend to be traditional people. They're not radical. They're fairly conservative. Their values are emotional. It is the first water sign in astrology, so it's primary water. It deals with family, hearth, home, the birth of children, continuity. So you can see this kind of conservative sort of fusion going on in his chart with Venus, which is really what he cares about. And again, his Venus is conjunct, who's Mercury? Donald Trump. It is exact. It's an exact conjunction between his Venus and Trump's Mercury. Okay, so we've set the stage here. Where is his Mars? His Mars is in Scorpio. Very intense, very powerful, and that Mars is in conjunction, wide, a little bit wide. You know, we're talking 6 degrees on the sun side with Mars, 12 degrees, not too bad, 6 degree orb. We've got a Mars-Sun conjunction. He's got a lot of life force. Anytime you get Mars-Sun together, people tend to be driven. They tend to have, you know, a lot of focus, a lot of fire. And what sign? Scorpio. It's in the underworld.
Yeah.
Totally in the underworld. Now, he's got Jupiter in Capricorn, which is our institutions and our government, right? So we have Jupiter, Capricorn, and in his chart, that's at 8 degrees. Where it says sun, his sun is at 6 degrees, Cancer in opposition. So he, in a lot of ways, he's in opposition to the institutions.
Yeah.
Very interesting kind of breakdown inside of his chart.
Yeah.
Now we look at his Saturn. His Saturn is at 9 degrees. What sign? Scorpio. Now in his chart, Scorpio is retrograde. So, and Saturn is retrograde. And what is Saturn? Again, Saturn's the ruler of Capricorn. So we're always getting into institutional relationships with Saturn. Doesn't matter what sign Saturn is in, it is that it is institutional. So here it is, Scorpio, he's going down deep into the relationship between institutions, and it's retrograde. It's going backwards. It's like going back and, you know, trying to pull things out. You know, what happens when we look at the videos that he and Veritas have created, we're going back in time with him. Yeah. We're having a retrograde moment. So now we have Mars in Scorpio and we have Saturn in Scorpio. This guy's driven. He's driven by things that we cannot really completely understand. Maybe we can go into some kind of, you know, past life meditation with him, but his desire is to get to the bottom of, you know, something profound, something transformational. And it, you know, Scorpio does not deal in areas of gray. I mean, this is all black and white stuff here. And what's interesting about James O'Keefe is that he kind of really came onto the scene with the Planned Parenthood videos, which I thought were brilliant, by the way. Absolutely.
The Planned Parenthood and the Acorn. Those were the one, the other ones he's done that.
That's right. And the Acorn videos. Yeah. The Planned Parenthood stuff is very Scorpionic.
Yeah.
You know, you're getting into, you know, because with Scorpio, we get into conception.
Yeah.
And we come into birth with Taurus, you know, the physical form and the body, but we also go into death with Scorpio.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's really getting into that zone in that world with Planned Parenthood and placentas and products and all those things that came out of those conversations. Now he's got Uranus in Sagittarius. And so we've had Saturn kind of around his natal Uranus. Again, it's in his chart, Uranus is retrograde, so it's going backwards. Sagittarius wants to get to the truth. So Saturn has been on and around his natal Uranus for the past 5 months. So I can assume that he's been doing a lot of kind of Saturnian, Uranian work, trying to break this mainstream code with this Uranian kind of radical and rebellious, let's get to the truth participation between these two planets. Like, this is his time to do this.
Yeah.
His natal Neptune is also in the sign of Sagittarius. It too is retrograde. So there's a lot of retrogradism in his chart, really starting from Saturn, Uranus, and then Neptune. It goes to 29 Sagittarius, which is that anaretic degree. It's an outer planet. So the outer planets sort of take a back seat to the inner planets for the individual, but the outer planets are like gods in the chart, and we are moved by them in ways that we don't really understand.
Yeah.
So at the 29th degree, the anaretic degree, Sagittarius in Neptune, we're trying to get to the truth through the foggy haze of Neptune, and he has a strong commitment to do this at the 29th degree. Now, it does not move into opposition with his Gemini planets, i.e. his Mercury, it's way too far away. So he's not really getting into that super wide conjunction. He might have an opposition with his moon. Again, I don't know because I don't know the time of his birth, but it could be a Neptune-Moon opposition. And again, with the moon, we're dealing with things like Planned Parenthood, fertility cycles, the moon, all those things that are associated with the moon. He also has Pluto at 20, again, here's that number 29 again, 29 degrees Libra. What does Libra want to do? It wants to be fair. It wants to be just. It wants balance more than anything. And he's born at a very unusual time where he has a Pluto-Neptune sextile at 29 degrees. So the anaretic degree in both signs, this guy has a karmic obligation. He has a karmic duty to do what he's doing. He's catching a lot of flack for it. He's being smeared by the media. And, you know, nobody's perfect.
Right.
If somebody was perfect, trust me, they wouldn't be part of this mess. I wouldn't even be here. So, you know, he's got skeletons, but this guy has been tasked with this gig in his life, and he's fulfilling
I feel like what the thing with him is this, he has skeletons in his closets, but it doesn't matter because of the way he's produced his work. No skeleton in his closet could have made those Democrats say the operatives say those things. You know what I mean? This isn't an article he's written. He's not saying someone said this. It's them on the videotape saying what they're saying. So it almost doesn't matter about him or his merits or his credibility or anything like that, because unless he is the most like masterful ventriloquist in the world or something like that, it is what it is. And why are these people stepping away and being fired and replaced and things like that? You know, if same thing with the WikiLeaks thing, why is
no, he's almost like a conduit for the whole thing in a sense.
Oh, absolutely. And I'm not even done. He's got his true note in Gemini. And his true note is conjunct Mercury, and he's got Chiron in Gemini. And Chiron in Gemini is healing a split between the bicameral mind. People of Chiron and Gemini are able to move, you know, very quickly back and forth between, you know, both domains or of their brain. And it could be a little schizophrenic, you know, Chiron, Gemini people or Chiron in the third house, you know, but they're here to play with identity and to roll with it. And remember, when we get into Chiron, we're dealing with Saturn and Uranus, you know, the conflict between the status quo and the establishment, which is Saturn. And Uranus, which is rebellious, radical, and wants to bring change. And he's trying to bring both of these together through Chiron and the conjunction with the true node is exact. In a weird way, he's a healer. He's a very interesting kind of healer that is, you know, hopefully fusing and bringing this quality of information and truth together. Fascinating chart. Absolutely fascinating. He's got fire. Does not have a lot of earth in his chart. The only earth he has is this Jupiter in Capricorn. That's it. So it's expanding. This Jupiter expands, and it's this notion of dealing with these institutions that really grounds him. His work grounds him. Very little else does. If he did not have these institutions, so what is James O'Keefe going to do after Trump gets elected? Where is he going to go at that point? It's almost like he's done.
Yeah.
Like he's over with. So this is a very important time for him. And this might actually be in some ways the apex of his creation, of his existence to some extent.
Do you think he's in danger?
He might be. People tend to drop like flies. You know,
does his chart show anything like that?
Well, we'd have to get into Scorpio a little bit here. And his Mars and Scorpio, let me see here, Pluto. Well, I'll tell you what, he's got next year, he's got a Uranus-Pluto opposition. That could be tricky for him with Uranus and Aries, Pluto and Libra, and that'll be towards the end of 2017. That could be tricky, but it wouldn't be now.
Okay.
It wouldn't be now, but it would be towards the end of 2017. It's almost like he's too well known at this point for something to happen to him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. That was amazing. That breakdown was really good. So I was just out of curiosity, have you done any looking at Julian Assange's chart?
You know, I have actually, and Julian Assange is born on the 3rd of July, which
so another Cancer.
Okay. Not only Cancer, again, like James O'Keefe, it puts his son in exact conjunction with the United States sun, right? So we have United States 4th of July, Julian Assange 3rd of July.
Yeah. Huh.
Very interesting. His Mercury is also in the sign of Cancer. It is conjunct Donald Trump's Saturn and Donald Trump's Venus in Cancer. Huh. So here we see this link between, you know, through Mercury, you know, through Donald Trump's Mercury to James O'Keefe's sun, through Julian Assange's Mercury to Donald Trump's Saturn, his Venus. You know, you have three characters here that are invested in the realm of Cancer and Cancerian values. Julian Assange, his son, is in what house? It's in the 8th house, which puts it in the house of Scorpio. Again, the muckraking, the going beneath the surface of things to bring something up and out and resurrect it. Now, he has, this is really interesting. He has his moon in Scorpio, and he has Jupiter in Scorpio, and both of those are in the 12th house. And so the moon, technically speaking, is where you live, or it represents the quality of your domicile and how you relate to your surroundings emotionally.
Yeah.
And so for him, his moon is in the 12th house.
Yeah.
You never see him. You know, yeah. He's in this Ecuadorian consulate. That is a total moon 12th house aspect.
Mm-hmm.
We never see Julian Assange. And Jupiter is there as well. You know, he's dealing with a foreign government. Jupiter rules anything that's foreign or anything that's connected to other countries and you know, people and places overseas. So, you know, he's completely aligned in a lot of ways with, you know, with his chart. Now, you and I were talking, Emily, I think while Randy was taking a break, you know, does Julian Assange even exist anymore?
Is he with us? Yeah.
We don't know. I mean, with all, you know, with Moon and Jupiter in Scorpio, now we've got the Scorpio sun going into his 12th house. It's very interesting. We don't know. We don't know if he's, you know, people have been saying, I've been reading about this, that his tweets are really different.
Yeah.
You know, there's something really strange going on. He's gotten super defensive. You know, there's no real connection with him in terms of, you know, the visual world.
Yeah.
And Randy and I have talked about going a long way back to this guy, Peter Beter, and the Russian robotoids and all. I mean, you know, who really understands or knows
Peter Beter? Wow. Yeah.
What the level of reality is with these people anymore, or if they're even people at all. And might be really easy to, in some ways, just kind of, you know, operate Julian Assange as an AI program or, you know, one of these
AI hologram, some kind of.
You know, we're living with a very strange kind of relationship with the physical world.
Yeah, that's, me and Randy were talking about that a little bit in the first hour. And yeah, I think there has been a change in tone coming from WikiLeaks and supposedly Julian Assange over the course of, I'd say, particularly over the course of the last 6 weeks, that have led a lot of people to believe that he is either in custody or not with us anymore. And that account is totally compromised.
Yeah. Well, so I guess if that's the case, then he set up all the dead man switches so that they can continue to get the cables and continue to process them. But if he's gone and then the director, McFadden, is gone, then who's really running the show now, if that's the case?
I mean, I know there's several other people involved, including that woman who, her name is Birgitta Jónsdóttir. She's from Iceland, and she was part of that lawsuit with Chris Hedges against Obama because for that, you know, to make sure that he wouldn't be able to use the NDAA against them. And she became part of the government in Iceland after they fired their government. I know she was actively involved in WikiLeaks, and she's, you know, a reasonably legitimate person, I think. You know, she's, you know, so I don't know if she still is involved. I don't know who else is involved. I mean, I'm sure there's lots of people, but yeah, it is. I mean, it seems there hasn't been anything new in the last couple of days, but things have been coming out steadily. But you also have to wonder, like, Could that be part of a setup? Could they purposely be creating all this chaos by putting out all this information that'll be so inflammatory to cause all sorts of chaos and possibly violence and continue to split and divide people's minds and divide us further? What is going on? And then, you know, I think I told you over the break how some people, you know, Cliff High with his web bot kind of thing, is seeing that like something weird happens where there's like an election and Trump wins, but Hillary Clinton is missing, and so he doesn't actually become president and whatever. And, you know, does this feed into that? It's impossible to know. You know what I mean?
Well, the web bots kind of, you know, and Cliff High would probably admit this, the web bots kind of not as accurate as it once was.
Yeah. Well, they figured it out.
Because the emotional temperature of the internet itself is different now. And that's a dramatic, it would be interesting for you to inform us how something shifted in the internet. When we were talking about this in the first half, about all the disclosure that's gone on in the alternative media over the course of the summer, Zen Gardner, the death of Max Spears, a number of other people being outed, convergences, divergences of different alt groups. It felt to me like somewhere around the, I will say, the summer solstice, there was a shift that took place within the alternative media sphere specifically.
Yeah, well, you know, we've been dealing with Saturn in the sign of Sagittarius, and we've also been dealing with Uranus, you know, going forward and being direct in the sign of Aries. It's retrograde now, but these are two major movers and shakers when it comes to trying to understand kind of this volatility of information and sort of what's taking place on this kind of omnidimensional level, and how people are moving into a greater sense of awakening. Uranus and Aries, I've talked about this, you know, this is the lightning bolt. This is the individual finally starting to stand up and turn and, you know, kind of face the tide of oppression, or face the tide of history in a lot of ways. And this is happening. We're seeing a complete and outright rejection of, you know, standards. I mean, I was watching an interview with Obama not long ago, and it was at one of these, you know, kind of Hillary, you know, stumpers, and all of a sudden people are just chanting in unison, lock her up, lock her up. And this is at an Obama event. And they had to cut away from this. We've never seen anything like this.
So that brings me to, I have a question. So we did a show last week, and I hope everyone will go check it out, with Derek Brose from the Conscious Resistance. And the show was about voluntarism, peaceful anarchy, agorism, things like that, things that are near and dear to my heart. I don't participate in the political system anymore. Do you think this is a good time for that to rise?
Well, I do. I mean, I think that the politics are limited. They're limited. It's a system just like anything else. And I think for us to be really sustainable, we've got to bring it back home. We've got to make things smaller. You know, we have to move away from this kind of megalomaniacal, you know, superstructure that's been built. It is the beast. And what we're trying to do now is we're trying to slow that process down. And it is happening, you know, fast and furious. I don't know if you guys have been following what's been going on with China and Obama doing a deal in Cuba with China. Have you been following this at all?
I didn't hear about this.
So Obama went to Cuba. This is why he went to Cuba and opened Cuba up. He basically gave Cuba and the resort capacity of Cuba over to the Chinese. So the Chinese are going to be running resorts through their company called Haier, H-A-I-E-R, which is connected. I think they've got a 20% share.
Haier, yeah.
Built in.
Yeah.
So we could see sort of the skeletal systems of the global superstructure that's being not just created, you know, it's being created as we speak, but what's been going on behind us for the last 20 years, 30 years since the Clintons began their overtures towards China. It's all becoming visible. You know, the transparency, which is ironic, the transparency that Barack Obama touted and talked about is becoming, to some extent, real, but it's becoming real in spite of him.
Yeah.
So I think that ultimately, if we can bring these things home and make them closer to either a state level or a local level and put the brakes on these multinationals. Now, people think that Trump is going to come in and stop all that. No, Trump has his own sweetheart deals with multinationals.
Yeah.
His alliance is there. Not only that, but he's a casino guy.
I was talking with a client of mine whose brother-in-law, this is a wealthy client that lives in Houston, and Trump flew to Houston and he met with a lot of these energy guys down in Houston. And he told him, he said, look, you know, if I'm president, here's what's happening. And Trump is going to push the Keystone Pipeline through. Trump is going to make sure that all the coal mines in Virginia are up and running and pumping and humming. And Trump will not abate on any kind of drilling or any kind of fracking in the United States. Trump will be full on energy. So people, you know, he's going to have
this full on old energy. That's the sad part of this.
It is. And unfortunately, what's happened is that we've outsourced so much of our industry and so much of our production that we've had to have this fallback on you know, domestic energy and the havoc that it's wrought on our environment and our water, because we don't have anything to replace it. We don't have any other, you know, infrastructure in terms of building and manufacturing. It's terrible.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, we're going from kind of
we actually do. I think my question to you is this, because you sort of inserted sideways here a little prediction, because you said when Trump is president. So I'm assuming the augurs are sort of leaning towards Trump, right?
I think he's going to become president.
I'll tell you something.
I think so too.
The last couple days, that screen has started to come back to life again. This is the first in remote viewing. We're starting to see a little bit of light and it's leaning towards Trump. This is a first. Something again shifted.
Something major shifted. And I just got this text sent to me from a friend of mine who is really up on this stuff. He lives down in Miami, Florida, and he's in deep with the alt-right and some of the Republican operatives. And this was a tweet that he got. This is a guy that's inside the Beltway. Everyone is trying to distance themselves from both the RNC and the DNC as institutions. The mood in the Beltway is chaotic. Lots coming up to me whispering they know Trump is going to win. Even more backstabbing than usual. So there are some murmurs with the insiders, that, and they know, as much as that they can try to rig the polls, I think the voter turnout is going to be massive. It's unlike anything we've ever seen before or in recent years. And it is going to be overwhelming, I think, towards Trump. I really felt for a while that Hillary was going to be in control of this thing. Randy, something shifted.
Yeah.
In the past week,
it was like boom, deep impact. Something shifted. It wasn't like a mild plate shift. It was like you felt this. You felt this in the.
You know what? It's sounds.
When I describe it, what I'm saying is, I feel it here. It's like that shift that pushes energy out. That's what it was like.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. I heard this and it sounded like kind of like a silly small thing, but if you think about it, it's actually quite brilliant that there's this thing that people are planning to do, at least certainly on people on the right, and they're all planning to wear red when they go to the polls. That way, so if they try and steal the election, all the video of people going to polls will be of people wearing red. You know, it's like a very low-tech way of like making a statement about that. I mean, obviously that, you know, doesn't count in the ballot box and, you know, whatever, it's not a real poll. But I thought that's like, that's something kind of clever that people probably should have been thinking of all along in this era where we don't have paper ballots. You know what I mean? They're not going to be able to show footage. If they try and steal it, they're not going to be able to show footage from the polling places of people. You know what I mean? It'd be kind of weird.
Right. And red is the color of Aries too, right? The ram.
Yeah.
And so Uranus and Aries, we have people. And again, nobody's got a patent, or nobody has a copyright on awakening. You know, it's not just one sector of society.
Everybody left is waking up too. Yeah.
Lots of people are waking up.
Yeah. You know, my dad actually, we were at breakfast the other day, and we knew about Trump and Clinton, and he knows that I don't vote, and I think they're both terrible. But I finally said to him that I think that she's worse. And he said, in some ways, yes, which is something he would not have conceded to me before. So my father is very sternly left. And the fact that he even conceded that, there is shift going on in people's hearts and minds, I think.
I think one of the issues that we're dealing with is both parties have really no fallback positions at this point. Both of them basically collapsed in front of us in the season leading up to the conventions, largely because the Democrats were caught with their fingers in the cookie jar. They screwed Bernie. You know, in a righteous world, if votes counted, it would have been Sanders against Trump, which would have in some ways been a much
more... Sanders would have won. Sanders probably would have won.
It would have been a very interesting... Yeah. Ideologically, we wound up non-ideological politics, a political season that became more about scandal.
That's right.
And toxic personalities. The other side of it is the Republicans. The schism is so wide now. The old school, hardcore, right-wing neocons have basically gone into the closet. You know, whoever they vote for, it doesn't matter. Their party has been severed in half.
Destroyed, yeah.
So, you know, the two columns themselves are almost rendered right now politically in this country. We don't really have a solid coalition on either side that's identifiable, which is an historical phenomenon.
We've never seen anything like this, ever.
And Trump's more of an independent than anybody who's ever run as an independent. He used the Republican Party to get into position so that he would not be a third-party candidate, which everybody knew was an automatic win for Hillary.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. You're absolutely right. I mean, he's an independent that's masquerading as a Republican, and he's doing what Ron Paul tried to do. And the thing about Trump, and I, you know, I've struggled with Trump a lot as this thing has gone on. And I have, you know, looked at this from many, many different angles. And people would say, well, you know, if he wasn't, you know, currying some favor with the powers that be, if he weren't a stalking horse or a straw man, they wouldn't be giving him all this coverage, because look what happened to Ron Paul. There's a huge difference between Ron Paul and Donald Trump.
Yeah, one has charisma and one doesn't.
Exactly. And one had a TV show with massive ratings.
Yeah.
And the other one could, you know, I mean...
Trump's always been a showman. He was a showman on a regional level. I remember him in New York City in the late 70s. Trump was known then, and he was known by his friends, the Goombas. Let's face it. At the end of the day, Trump has a lot of alliances. One of them is mob guys. Mm-hmm. That's just flat. And yep. I've been saying that since last spring.
Yeah.
Okay. Does that make everybody's got a gang. Everybody's got a posse. His is the Goombas and some other people that he's, you know, obviously in business with. That's not a bad thing or a good thing. It just is.
Yeah.
But he's known for being a showman. He's known for putting on a hell of a good party. And he's kind of colorful. And he says dumb fuck stuff at the worst possible time, too. That's going to be the next president if Trump's elected. We're going to have to live with the fact that this guy's, he's going to say new stuff we've never seen a president do before.
No, I agree. I think it's going to be absolutely fascinating. We're going to be in a brave new world.
Yeah.
And Trump is decidedly conservative. I mean, if you saw what he said during that debate, the last debate, he made no bones over the fact that he is pro-life. I have never seen a candidate do that in my lifetime. Though him
Reagan,
and all,
well, Reagan did it. Reagan did it.
Yeah, Reagan did.
But he was
I was not that into politics back then. I was.
That was part of the Reagan platform. He managed to pull together the right wing coalition at that time. That was pro-life. That was one of the factions that way. It was a Christian right.
So we have not seen this since Reagan.
He's very much like Reagan in some aspects. He's not articulate like Reagan. He's articulate in a more streetwise kind of way.
Mm-hmm.
He's not a script reader. He rarely uses a teleprompter. I watched his speech from Florida today. As nearly as I can tell, he was off the cuff. He was just rolling with it. In some ways, he's like a stand-up comedian.
It's really interesting. David Livingstone, who's a pretty good researcher, had this big piece on Trump, and he links Trump to the Discordians and Bob Dobbs and Robert Anton Wilson.
Yeah.
And he thinks that
he's a disruptor.
Yeah, and he thinks that Trump was just doing this as a lark, as some kind of performance piece. And I think somewhere along the way, it got real for him. And maybe this is the shift that you've
said that too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody has a shift.
Yeah.
You know, when Obama was elected, and obviously I didn't vote for Obama, but I said for a couple of years on my old show, he will have his dark night of the soul. That was just something that I saw and felt about him. I think with Trump, it got real at some point, to the point where he had to decide. I think he went off script. I think he strayed off the reservation. I think he started as a Hillary cutout, to be quite honest with you.
I agree with you 100%.
Yeah. I think he started as a Hillary cutout, some kind of useful idiot. And I think Trump is comfortable with a certain level of corruption, like a mafia style corruption, you know. But I think when he saw how unhumanly corrupt and how just absolutely completely devoid of any kind of morals or respect for anything it was, I think that something about that did bother him. And so I do think there's been a shift with him. I can't say that I'm 100% for that, but I have that feeling that he realized halfway through this that, like, wait a second, I didn't sign up for this rodeo. You know what I mean?
I also think he was threatened. And I think that's the point at which you commit.
Yeah.
You know, now it's safer to live in the open, and it's safer to go for the full let's rock and roll.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think to back this up, you know, I've been listening to people for years, you know, the last 8 years of my life. My life has been one of being an intense listener, you know, when I work with clients. So I can get into where somebody is congruent or incongruent. And I listened to Trump over the last 3 weeks, and I heard things in his voice that I'd never heard before. That there was a depth and a commitment and a sincerity that was completely congruent. And I don't need to do David John Oates to figure that out.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Somebody is coming at that level, and then you have the robotoid, you're running this completely, you know, predetermined script that she's either running off of a teleprompter in a debate or on the screen of her mind. There's just no comparison. You're dealing with digital and analog.
Yeah.
Very good point. So shall we move into the playoffs and the World Series and all this stuff? Do you get into some baseball?
We could. Right now, the Indians are winning 3-0, as I have you on the background. A really interesting guy who was on my radio show is an author. His name is Stephen Creamy. And he wrote this amazing book called Catabatic Winds, Good Crate Fueled by Fumes from the Abyss. I highly recommend it. And he gets into this whole section in the book.
Hold that book cover up so we can see it. A little higher.
There it is, right there.
All right. Okay. That's an interesting book.
This is a really good book. He talks about the number 108, the Mysterium. And it is the number of music, 108. He goes into all of these pieces around it. 108 equals the sum of the first nine multiples of three. The factors of 108 can be divided nicely into all the major harmonic proportions, 2, 5, 3, 4, to give you the perfect fourth and fifth of the octave. In geometry, it is the inscribed angle of the pentagon, 108 degrees. 108 is the complement to the 72-72, 36 golden triangle inscribed within the pentagon. Each cut of the pentagon yields to the golden mean proportion. So 108 is really fascinating. We are 1,080 miles away from the moon. The diameter of the sun is 108 times greater than the diameter of the earth. 108 times the diameter of the sun equals the distance of the sun to the earth. Amazing numbers, right?
Yeah.
Totally amazing stuff. It says here 108 million Roman half paces equals the circumference of the earth. The orbit of Saturn is 10,800 days, and out of that we get 108, right? There are 108 sacred stars in Taoist astrology. So we could go on and on and on. It says here that there are 10,080 human breaths per hour, 18 per minute. What else do we have here? There are 108 days from All Souls Day to Christmas. Movement from darkness to light. 108 intersects the yugas in interesting ways. So he's got the Kali Yuga, the Vapara Yuga, the Treta Yuga, the Kirti Yuga, and the number 108 interacts with all of them. And of course, it's been 108 years since the Cubs.
That's what I was wondering where we were going. That's what I thought.
That was the wind-up to it all.
Yeah.
So the Cubs are involved in this amazing kind of cosmology of this number 108. So let's see how this plays out. If it is indeed connected to this cosmology, then the Cubs theoretically should win.
Yeah. What do they call it? The end of the curse of the goat? The curse of the billy goat?
The billy goat curse, yeah. There's all kinds of, you know, Baphomet imagery around that billy goat.
There's a really good, it's from several months back, but the Gematria guy, Zachary Hubbard, did a really good video about the curse of the billy goat and the Cubs. So people should go check that out. That's pretty interesting there. So what do you think? So you think they're going to win, but you were mentioning to me offline that the Indians could give them trouble. Is that representative of the Lakotas rising up at the pipeline?
Hey, it could be. We've got the Indians, which are, you know, coming back into our consciousness and our psyche as, you know, people are going off the res, just like we were talking about with Trump and having kind of a renegade relationship with the mainstream media and politics in general. The Indians are interesting. You know, we had the Cavaliers.
Yeah.
You know, winning the NBA champion. And by the way, that was completely thrown and fixed.
I agree.
The NBA. But that's a whole other story. And we essentially have these two teams that are associated with losing. You know, Cleveland is Loserville. The Chicago Cubs, not the White Sox, since the White Sox won a few years back. You know, again, it's Loserville. So these are teams that are underdogs, and somebody is going to prevail. And it's either the team that last won 108 years ago, the other team who last won in 1948, it's a long time ago.
Yeah.
We're going to see something unique and remarkable. And it's been a big year for Cleveland, you know, the Republican National Convention, the Cavaliers, the Indians. You know, maybe if they're going to defeat this this 108 logical phenomenon. Maybe this is the team that will do. And if they do, well, what does that mean for 108? Do we just start? Right.
The wind's going to start blowing the other way.
What's really interesting is last year, the Cubs were in the playoffs. And this was the year, last year, 2015, where in Back to the Future, they're supposed to be the winners of the World Series.
Oh, so maybe maybe time has changed on a different timeline or Mandela effect or something.
You know, this goes back to Trump. Yeah. And I have this theory about Trump, which I might have talked about before with you guys. I'm not sure, but when Kennedy was assassinated, or even if you're in Miles Mathis' universe, decided to check out.
We love Miles Mathis.
We do too. Yes, we love Miles Mathis.
But I don't fully embrace everything that Miles Mathis.
No, but it's brilliant and entertaining either way.
Oh, he's great. He's great. But it doesn't matter whether Kennedy decided to take a pat or go live with Marilyn Monroe, in an underground base somewhere, or he was actually killed. The same effect took place.
That's right.
And we were living on this one path, this one timeline, and I'd like to believe, and I'll put my belief in quotes, I'd like to believe that Kennedy was assassinated and not that we weren't ripped off.
Yeah.
Because we were headed in a direction. Yeah. We were headed in a, and I've researched this. It's one of my most visited posts, in that there's this timeline that happens with Kennedy. We diverge. We go off onto a different timeline. And what happens is you have all these Gemini markers that are part of this timeline. I call it the Gemini timeline, or the Kennedy timeline as it relates to Gemini. And if you go into what happens in his assassination, it takes place in Dallas, and George Bush is, he's the operative, right? He's there in Dallas basically running the show. And he happens to be what? A Gemini, right? So now we have two Geminis, we have Bush and we have Kennedy. So we have this duality and this split, this divergence. And then we go off into Johnson, who is a Virgo, Virgo being ruled by Mercury. The other ruler that Mercury has is Gemini. So now we have the two sides of Mercury, Gemini and Virgo. Then we have Johnson creating the new society, the Great Society, the welfare state, NPR. It all happens right there. The Beatles kick in right at that time. They release their first record in North America just days after Kennedy is assassinated.
I didn't know that. That's true. Really interesting.
So the Beatles play this role. And you can see, even in relationship to the releases, like, when Bobby Kennedy gets killed, I believe that's right around when
I heard the news
Helter Skelter, Revolution 9, those records.
1968, it was the release.
It's right at the same time. So there are these interesting releases with the Beatles records that happen along this timeline, which takes us out into MK Ultra and, this explosion.
Well, maybe all these plots, all these things come from the Tavistock Institute.
That's right. But we're talking about Gemini because we split. Yeah. We split off.
Yeah.
And then, time passes and we're starting to come back, back into this sort of, maybe this realignment with this timeline. Yeah. And then what happens on 9/11/2001, we have, of course, 9/11, and 9/11 is the Twin Towers. The moon is in Gemini, Saturn is in Gemini. And who's the president at that time? It is the son of George Herbert Walker Bush. So now we have the two Bushes, again, Gemini, double.
Knocking us off of timelines.
Absolutely. And now we're back, into this other timeline, where we pretty much started off and, we're no longer kind of diverging. It's almost like it's a ritual. It's a reaffirmation of that thing. And then, of course, you have Larry Silverstein, who's a major player with the World Trade Center, and he's a Gemini. So we have all these Gemini confluences that take place at that time. Then we have the one, the one World Trade, Freedom Tower, whatever it's called now. But look who's on the stage. It's Donald Trump. And what is Donald Trump? He's a Gemini. He's a Gemini. Uranus a Gemini. Trudeau a Gemini. And he is probably kind of the closest to an outsider that we've had since Kennedy, who Randy, as you know, had all these gangland connections.
Yeah.
With the mafia, the Jewish mafia, the Italian mafia.
That's right.
And also liked how, you know, lots of women and all this kind of stuff that Trump is sort of.
Absolutely.
Yeah. No, it actually is. There's a lot of parallels here.
And then what's really weird, right, is that there's a very strange video of Rudy Giuliani in drag looking like a cross between Carol, what's her name, on Hollywood Squares. I forget her last name.
Carol Burnett.
No, the other one. The one with the big eyes. Carol.
Carol Kane.
This Carol woman, and Marilyn, he looks like Marilyn Monroe. Rudy Giuliani, Marilyn Monroe. And here's Trump. He's at a mayor's conference, and he's like putting the moves on Rudy Giuliani in drag. It's really weird. But Rudy Giuliani's looking like Marilyn Monroe. And so here you have this kind of reenactment of the Kennedy-Monroe thing. It's bizarre.
Yeah. While we're on the Trump thing, the thing keeps popping into my head. I just want to tell people, if you want to see something really funny, do any of you guys know Chris Duane, the guy who makes silver coins with like different anti-government kind of sayings on them and things like that? He has a new coin out that says Vote Trump. He's anti-government, but he has a Vote Trump one out. It has his hair with a star in it, and the bottom it says We Shall Overcome. It is so funny.
I love it. We Shall Overcome. That's great.
Yeah, everyone's going to take a look at it.
That's hilarious. Rudy Giuliani, by the way, is a Gemini.
Of course.
May 28th. So, you know, we're in this Gemini cycle. And perhaps with Trump, we might be able to reconverge back with the Kennedy timeline, which would be very interesting.
Yeah.
Very interesting. And by the way, we're also looking at this kind of Bay of Pigs thing, maybe, with Syria and Aleppo and the Russians, right? Yeah. It's all fascinating stuff.
Yeah. No, it actually is quite similar. Yeah. That's very interesting. Is Marilyn Monroe a Gemini?
She is. May 31st.
Yeah. Wow. I just had a suspicion she might be.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. All right. Well, guys, Robert, before we go, I want you to tell everybody about your new YouTube series, 15 Minutes of Flame. I love catching that.
Yeah, it's great.
Okay, so I've been doing these little 15-minute vignettes, and I do them every day now. I start off on Blog Talk Radio. I stream them, and then I download them, and I put them up on YouTube so you can experience them two ways. It's just me trying to, you know, fit something into a really short 15-minute piece. And it takes a lot of effort to not go on and on and on and talk and try to connect some dots and some ideas. And it's very easy for people to listen to. And I'm doing a live stream, an astrological live stream on YouTube on Sunday nights. And I'm continuing to produce content for my website. I do readings.
Tell everybody what your website is again.
It's robertphoenix.com. And if you're listening to this broadcast and you can tell me that you've listened to this broadcast, I'll be happy to give you the Randy Moggins.
Let's say the password is Gemini.
Gemini is the password. I will give you, I'll give you a 25% discount on any service or anything you wanted to get from my website. I have a 16-hour video course if you want to learn about astrology. You could just, you know, it's a really, and look, I am not one at tooting my own horn, but you can go out and you can spend $3,000 and get a video, an astrological video course from a fairly well-known and famous astrologer, or you could spend roughly, what do we have it at? $295 for my 16-hour course. And get the same thing.
And I just have to say for everybody, I've had a reading. Oh, sorry.
Words of value. So I'm putting that out there to people. Just letting them know it's available.
Everybody,
so if you're interested in astrology, and you want to learn on your own, 16 hours. We've got labs and we've got all kinds of really good stuff, lectures, and that's available on our website. And again, use the code word Gemini. I'll give you 25% off that. I hate being a pitch man, but I have to do this.
Well, then, let me pitch you. So just so everyone knows, I've had a reading from Robert. That's actually sort of how we met and started all of this. And it was a couple years back, and it continues to, a full reading anyway. It continues, things continue to line up with what he said. And it was, I didn't know what to expect. I'd never had anything like that before. And it certainly surpassed anything I expected. And also, maybe next time you come on, we can have you do some mini readings on air for the listeners.
I'd love to. That'd be great. I'd love to do that. And I just want to say real quickly, it's been really interesting watching the synergy take place between Off-Planet Radio and some of the stuff that I'm doing, because I can see people that are connecting on your side on the Facebook end from my world, Randy, and then coming over. It's really cool to see this take place.
Yeah.
This is where the magic happens.
Yeah.
I think this we all sync up nicely. Yeah.
Yeah, we want to build natural relationships with people that are like-minded and like-hearted. That's really the goal.
Yep.
Not this fake stuff that's been going on for too long.
I'm sorry, I keep interrupting.
That's okay. Are we going to back out of this thing?
I think we're there.
All right.
We're going to take a few weeks off because Randy's going to need to go on a much needed little vacation, but we'll be back in 2 weeks or so with some more great shows. We have some interesting things coming up. And that's it, man.
Hey, thank you for having me on. I really appreciate it, guys.
No, thanks for coming on with us because you help pull a lot of things together for us in a way that has a lot of meaning. And I'm learning a lot from you, and I'm going to learn more because I want to get this course, and I want to get a reading, and I want to dig into this more. Got to do that. Hey, listen, it's been fun. We'll be back in a few. You won't miss us. There'll still be stuff coming.
There's new shows coming, yeah.
Yeah, there's new shows coming. So you'll barely even notice I'm gone. Anyway, if you're going to vote your heart. If you're not going to vote, keep your heart on the people who are and the people who are going to run this country. We're in decision point right now, and I get it. Most of us are apolitical, but they do affect our lives. So whatever your practices spiritually, keep that in mind as we go through this period, this election cycle.
Intend
this
is our prayer. Yeah.
Absolutely. Pray for peace. Truth is out there. It's inside you. We'll be back very soon with another show. Good night for now.
Thanks, Ben. All right.